Your Dog's Friend is a nonprofit 501c3 whose mission is to help keep dogs out of shelters by educating and supporting their humans. We promote positive method of training and behavior modification through stress-free methods. As part of that mission, we offer free webinars like the one you're about to watch. Subjects range from dog behavior, stress-free training, and other tools to help you understand your relationship with your dog. If you like the webinar, be sure to give us a thumbs up. Click the notification bell and subscribe to our channel. By subscribing, you'll be notified when future videos are posted. Now enjoy the webinar.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar, Canine Enrichment, sponsored by Your Dog's Friend, a nonprofit 501c3, whose mission is to help keep dogs out of shelters by educating and supporting their humans. Since 2006, we've been promoting the use of positive dog training methods by hosting free webinars just like this one, posting valuable resources on our website, offering affordable training classes in person and online, and providing free advice and referrals. We are passionate about our mission, so we hope you will enjoy this webinar and spread the word about Your Dog's Friend. My name is Carrie Horn. I'm a volunteer with Your Dog's Friend and will be your host for today's webinar. Kayleigh Sullivan is our presenter this evening. She has been training animals using positive reinforcement-based training for over 10 years, including working with elephants at the National Zoo. Kayleigh has a BA in animal sciences with a focus on animal behavior. She graduated from the Karen Pryor Academy and is also a certified professional dog trainer knowledge assessed. Kayleigh works with dogs and their people through JW Dog Training and Behavior in and around Northwest Washington, D.C. She also teaches an online cooperative care class through Your Dog's Friend. Kayleigh creates and evaluates enrichment plans for our canine companions and has years of experience helping zoo and aquarium animals live more enriched lives. And she has tons of videos, so this should be a fun one. We're looking forward to learning what enrichment is and how we make our dogs' lives more fun and fulfilling. Before we begin, let me remind you again that Your Dog's Friend is a nonprofit. So if you find this webinar helpful, please consider making a donation to help support these free webinars and other free resources that we offer. If you would like to donate, you can visit our website at yourdogsfriend.org and click on the donate button in the upper right-hand corner. We really appreciate and need your support. So let's get started with today's webinar. I'm sure everybody's really excited to hear more about canine enrichment. I know I am. So I'm going to hand it over to you, Kayleigh.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Carrie. So this is about canine enrichment. My name is Kayleigh Sullivan. So let's get started. So this is a little bit about me. I worked mostly at the Smithsonian's National Zoo for a very long time. I also did some work at the Elephant Sanctuary in Tennessee. I had done some consulting work at Wildlife SOS in India. That's a wildlife rescue. I also was an intern at the Shedd Aquarium in Chicago. And some of the species that I've worked with include elephants, primarily elephants, but I've also worked with sea lions, seals, birds of prey, otters, ravens, maned wolves, beluga whales, and dolphins. Currently, I work with dogs. As you can see there, my little guy, Kai in the corner. I currently provide private lessons through JW Dog Training and Behavior Consulting. I also do some group classes through Your Dog's Friend. Check out the cooperative care class if you're interested in grooming, nail trimming, all of that. It's a really great class. I really enjoy it. And I also do some work for the Humane Society of the United States. So what's on the agenda for today? So we're going to discuss what is enrichment, why it's important, scheduling enrichment, and how to evaluate it. So what exactly is enrichment? So I have a few definitions laid out here. Feel free to read them at your own pace, or if you watch the webinar later, you can definitely read those first two, but I'm gonna focus on the last two that I have there. As you can see with the first two, enrichment's not a very new concept. It's been around for a while, so these papers were written in the 90s. But enrichment was really focused on zoo animals. That's where it was primarily focused on. And currently, it's really been diving into the dog world, which I love seeing. Allie Bender and Emily Strong, they have a book out called The Canine Enrichment for the Real World, and they're really spearheading that enrichment for dogs, which is incredible. They're using it for behavior modification plans, and I highly recommend this book. But their definition I really love. they break it down as enrichment is learning what our dogs' needs are and then structuring an environment for them that allows them as much as feasible to meet those needs. And the way I like to define it in just very simplified terms is just basically allowing your dog the opportunity to be a dog. Pretty simple. So what exactly is enrichment? So like I mentioned, it was primarily focused on zoo animals. That's where a lot of that, where I don't know if it necessarily originated from, but that's definitely where we used it. We talked about enrichment in the zoo world just as much as you would talk about medical care, nutrition, training. Like enrichment is a big aspect of how we care for the animals in the zoos and sanctuaries and aquariums. So we tend to focus a lot, I feel like, especially with dogs on puzzle feeders. So that's a really big form of enrichment, puzzles. We give those a lot. If you are implementing enrichment, a lot of people will use puzzle feeders. We also do that with the zoo animals as well. So you can see this elephant here. It's easy enough to put down a bowl of food for your dog and then to just scarf it up in one bite or two or multiple, whatever. But for elephants, it would also be super easy to just throw down a flake of hay and they would just pick it up and just put the whole thing in their mouth. And then that's it. That's done. They've gotten that whole flake for, I don't know, an hour, however long we throw out hay for. We want them to, just like our dogs, to be mentally stimulated and to provide species-specific behavior. So elephants, when they're eating, sure, hay is a part of their diet, but so is browse. So in other words, sticks, branches, and leaves, and fruits, and vegetables. And in the wild, you would see elephants reaching up in trees, using their nose, using their sense of smell to pick out food up high that they can't necessarily see. They'd reach branches down, strip the leaves, eat that. So we want to sort of mimic that as best as we can so that they're able to display those behaviors that you would see in the wild. So here's a little video of that. This was at the elephant sanctuary. I actually worked with this elephant named Flora. And I love this little video. You can see her really using her nose, stretching up high. Her trunks are a combination of nose, upper lip, and a hand. So she's really using that appendage to grip and rip the food down, using it to smell what's up there. Like in this one, she's smelling, is it worth it, what's in there? And so you can see she's, if I were just to throw a flake of hay, that would be done in a second. So this is really great because it's simulating a lot of those different behaviors that they would do in the wild. And with elephants in particular, enrichment can be really challenging because elephants are very destructive. They're huge animals and it's just a part of their nature. They like to destroy things and knock things down. And so because of that, again, it's a natural behavior for elephants to want to destroy things. You'll see, especially male bull elephants when they're in must, just knocking down trees like they're nothing. But it's a good practice for when they're sparring with other bulls. And so at the Maryland Zoo, they actually created this enrichment item, which was awesome, because it allows this bull to basically do that behavior of sparring with a tree. So I think this is a female in this video, but you know how to do it. So if this item wasn't in this habitat, she would most likely be doing it on something else that we wouldn't probably want her to test out its strength. Hopefully everything there is elephant proof, and so you wouldn't have to worry about it. But this at least gives her the outlet to perform that behavior in a way that's, you know, conducive to what we're setting up in that space. And I love this video. I'm just going to play this and let them talk about it. It's just about scent enrichment in the zoo for cats. So I'm going to play this. This was at the Smithsonian Zoo. I actually worked with some of these people.
One of the ways we can enrich our animals is by using different scent enrichments, both in their indoor enclosures and in the outside areas as well, where the public can see. We want our animals to be as natural as possible. We want to encourage natural behaviors as much as possible. They all react in different ways, and we can judge what they really enjoy by trying different things. My favorite part of using scent enrichment is to encourage natural behavior. Just use a little bit of chicken smell, which is part of their diet, as well as blood, which sounds gross, but that is very natural for a cat to smell blood and then look for his prey. We spread it on the logs, no actual food items, but just the scent of the delicious meaty smells. Then the cat, when we let him out, you could see him walking around. He is sniffing the air. He is looking for that food item. He's really searching. He's really keeping him active, keeping him busy. Again, how they would be in the wild looking for their prey item. They would smell them, then they would go in search of them.
At the Great Cats exhibit, we generally use scent enrichment about twice a week. Today, the male lions got scent enrichment in their yard, and they received a combination of scent enrichment today. I put out a giant hay pile in the yard and sprinkled some pumpkin pie spice in it. Also, I got some farm poop from our kids' farm keeper this morning. That's cow, alpaca, and donkey, and I put that in little piles around the enclosure for them. The tigers received porcupine poop, which was generously donated by our three North American porcupines. There are a couple of purposes for using scent enrichment. One can simply be to offer the cats something new that they've never experienced before. Also, we can use it to introduce animals to each other. If we have two animals that we can't physically put together quite yet, we can swap their bedding back and forth so they can investigate each other's scent and investigate each other's yards. Our male and female caracal got enrichment in their yard as well. They got alpaca wool, which we got from our alpacas when they were sheared earlier this spring. And they also got a hay bed with pumpkin pie spice. Our male caracal, Kabaru, is particularly fond of pumpkin pie spice as well. Our bobcats received alpaca wool, herbivore poop, and pumpkin pie spice spread on a little boomer ball. Generally, the first response that you'll see from a cat when they investigate a scent is they'll either lick it or smell it, and then they'll go into what looks like a grimace, and it's actually called the Fleming response. And they basically are processing that scent through an organ that's at the base of their nasal cavity and waving that scent over to see if they can recognize anything. In the smaller cats, it's there. It's a little bit harder to notice. They might just wrinkle their noses. And generally, that's the first behavior that you see. And then if a cat seems to really like the scent, they'll actually rub their faces and heads in the scent and sometimes throw their whole bodies into it and just roll around in it. They have scent glands around their faces, and so they're also contributing back their scent to whatever they're smelling. Additionally, you may see a cat urinate on the scented area, and that's just another way for them to mark their territory and also deposit their scent on the item. If visitors would like to support the zoo's enrichment program, they can go to the zoo's website and click on Enrichment Giving Tree.
Okay, so a little bit more about what enrichment is. So I think that those videos really displayed a good idea of how we use enrichment in a zoo setting. It's not just about puzzle feeders and how you can feed the animals in different ways, but it's also about just species-specific behaviors as well, such as that Fleming response, sniffing and searching out, different smells and analyzing what they are, and then also shoving that tree. Like, that has nothing to do with food. That's just a species-specific behavior that elephants do. Enrichment is contingent on the item or activity being enriching. So what that means is that just because you put something out doesn't necessarily, or give it to your animal, doesn't necessarily make it enrichment. So what makes an enrichment is if it's actually enriching to your animal. So if I were to put pumpkin spice out for the elephants and the elephants walked right by it, didn't even investigate it at all, zero engagement, I wouldn't have checked that box for the day that I provided enrichment for the elephants, because it wasn't enriching to them. It's also important to collect data so we can determine if what we're providing is indeed actually enriching. So why enrichment matters? to improve or maintain an animal's physical and psychological health, increase the repertoire of species-specific behaviors, so similar to what we saw there with the Fleming response and the knocking down the tree, reduce the frequency of abnormal and unwanted behaviors, which is helpful for our dogs, increase positive utilization of the environment, and to increase the individual's ability to cope with the challenges of living in captivity, which our dogs are technically captive animals. They rely on us for everything. So I think that's sort of, we don't really view our dogs as captive. We view, like, you know, mice in a laboratory or zoo animals as captive animals, but dogs are too. So why enrichment matters again? Dogs are animals living in a human environment built for human needs. So there's, when it comes to zoo animals, at least nowadays, there's a whole team of people when they're designing exhibits where they specialize in making sure that that exhibit is designed for that specific species or animal, individual animal too sometimes. So with that, they're thinking about what type of substrate should we be using? Do we put pools in there? How big is the pool? Do we, you know, how big should the space be? Do they need social? Are they a social species? Do they need buddies? Do they need mates? Are they an isolated species? Maybe in that case, you wouldn't. So they're really, really creating this environment around that animal. Whereas dogs, they're living with us. They're living in our environment. So it's not necessarily made for them to be dogs. For them to perform most of their natural behaviors, we have to provide the opportunities for them. So like eating, we have to give them the food. We have to put the food down, whether it's in a bowl, whether it's in a puzzle feeder, whether it's a chew. To use the bathroom, that one always boggles my mind. It's the only animal that I can think of, aside from humans, that we require the animal to hold in their, you know, hold everything in and go when we feel like they need to go. So that's something that always sort of like really, I feel like, puts it into perspective for me about how incredible dogs are. Obviously, if they were going and if they couldn't hold it, they probably wouldn't be in our home. So it does work well for us that they can do that. But we sort of, I feel like, take that a little bit for granted. Socialization, we have to provide that for them, whether it's through us, whether that's through other dogs, even just running, especially if you live in an apartment and you don't have a big yard. And a dog on a 6-foot leash or just in your home, they really can't run around a whole lot. That's a normal behavior for dogs. So I really like these images because I feel like they really sort of put things into perspective. So at the bottom, you see a beautiful Dalmatian who's healing to your side and just walking. And I feel like the majority of people would look at that and be like, oh, I wish my dog would walk like that. That's what I wish my walks looked like. And that's fine. That's great. Healing is a great behavior. I'm not bashing healing. My dog knows how to heal. Healing is very useful in certain situations. So from getting from point A to point B, or for just, you know, passing by, you know, distracting stimulus, it can be helpful to have them in a heel, just get them past that. But it's really, that type of a walk to me is for the human. It's not for the dog. He really can't do anything. I don't know if you had a dog in a heel like that the whole time, can they even go to the bathroom when they're like that? Cause they can't really sniff around, to find a place to go. So to me, that's not a desirable walk if I'm wanting to do it for enrichment or for my dog. And up above, I like that image as well, because I think it really puts into perspective how limited our dogs can be on a short leash. So this is not even a short leash. It's probably 6 feet. It's norm standard size leash, but I'm sure these people who have these dogs are probably, oh, my dogs get so much socialization. They get pack walks with, you know, multiple dogs a day even. And so they get plenty of socialization, but how much socialization can these dogs do on a short 6-foot leash? They might get, you know, they can exchange facial expressions, maybe sniff each other's butt or do a little bit of air scenting. But aside from that, dogs communicate through their body language. And so on a 6-foot leash like that, or 6-foot leash like that, they're not really able to communicate and socialize in a way that they would do without the 6-foot leash. These are obviously just snapshots. I'm ragging on these photos, but I'm sure this guy's going to take them somewhere really cool. And this dog, you can tell they've got a clicker and treat pouch. So it's probably just training purposes and it's healing for the whole walk. But I do think it sort of puts it all into perspective. So what behaviors can these dogs express? walking, air scenting, maybe eliminating, hopefully eliminating, and barking. But that's about all I can think of. Maybe you guys can come up with some more, but so here are just some different ways to spice up your standard walk a little bit. So I'm a big advocate for long lines because that allows our dogs to get as much agency while still keeping them safe. My first video I have of me and my dog, and we are in a city environment. I do acknowledge that this is not something that every dog can do and that there is a lot of training involved in this, but it definitely shows you how a dog would naturally walk in a city environment without a whole lot of human intervention. And I do, obviously, I'm not going to let him go on the street and I'm not going to let him go straight up to a person because we don't know if the person's okay with dogs. So I have some boundaries, but for the most part, I'm just letting him dog. So I'll show you what this looks like. He's able to stop, sniff, whatever he wants. And keep trying to keep that leash as loose as I can so he doesn't feel any of it. And he can just continue to check everything out, sniff to sniff, zigzag, going from side to side. Oh, he's going to go up the stairs, check that out up there. And there was a little human intervention for me. I did a little treat toss, keeping him away from those people. I'm just going to jump up on there, check that out. See how much more exploration he's going to get. So he's going to come home pretty tired because he's doing a lot of mental stimulation, sniffing, checking everything out, exploring, as opposed to if he were just in a heel, walking. And then this one I love, again, a dog on a long line, Kai again, my puppy. This was when he was a puppy, and this is in Rock Creek Park. So just puppy zoomies, but I do really think it helps to show like dogs, a long line can be really, really helpful in letting our dogs dog a little bit more than they would on a 6-foot leash. And then this one is actually on a 6-foot leash. So this is me doing a little bit of city agility with my dog. So walks, even that first video that I showed, he's not getting a lot of physical exercise with that. He is getting a lot of mental stimulation, but in terms of physical exercise, he's a bigger dog and he's got a lot of physical needs. So I would say that just walking isn't going to cut it for him. So this is a way to sort of spice up your city walks. So we do a little bit of agility work, city agility or parkour. Game action. Neck four.
And then watch me do over on the chest. Watch it. Back up. Hey. Ready?
It's very fun for me. I'm having a good time. So it's great physical exercise. And then also he's using his brain. There is that mental stimulation element to it because we are training. And we're also socializing. I'm having a good time. He's having a good time. We're communicating with each other. So I would say there is a social aspect to this form of enrichment. Let's just keep going. So in terms of dog behaviors, these are all dog behaviors that I could think of that I wrote down in this cloud app. But some of them, you know, can be a little bit, we don't love all of these behaviors as humans, at least in excess, like barking, you know, the jumping up, chasing, growling even, that's a form of communication. What else is in there? Chewing, yeah. So all of these are normal, natural dog behaviors. And I think that's important to sort of think about when we do have our dogs, you know, doing certain things. We're like, ah, I don't love my dog doing that. But we also have to keep into perspective, that is a normal dog behavior. So when it came, I showed a bunch of videos of zoo animals doing or performing behaviors, and those are species specific behaviors. When it comes to dogs, or when it came to zoo animals or exotic animals, one thing I like to look into is how they are in the wild. And we'll do that. We'll actually go back and see, okay, especially if you're creating a new exhibit and you've never had that animal before, you'll not only talk to other zoos and find out, okay, how's the species? Okay, what kind of enrichment do you guys use and like? But we'll also look into how that animal is in the wild and how they behave in the wild. And for dogs, you can really look into street dogs. Street dogs are a great example because they don't have a whole lot of human intervention, and they have a lot of agency to do and perform whatever behaviors in their environment. So I love this little video of a street dog. Very picky. Oops. So this looks an awful lot like digging in your brand new flower bed that you just created. So again, a normal dog behavior. Why is she doing this? Not sure. Maybe there's, maybe it's cooler down or it's hot out. She needs to cool off. But also there might be something down there that she's interested in. So how can we take that behavior and allow them to do it in a way that's not going to destroy our flower bed? I love this. This is a great activity you can do. Same behavior. This one of a street dog. Tell me what behavior this reminds you of. Just gonna take that for the road. So it looks an awful lot like counter surfing, right? That's a survival instinct for dogs. They're not only hunters, they do kill prey. That is something they do, but they're also foragers. That's how they came to be with humans, was because of their foraging abilities. So that is a normal dog behavior. It's a survival instinct. Obviously, counter surfing is not ideal. So we do want to incorporate management and training to address that behavior. But you're going to have a lot easier time managing and training if you provide that outlet elsewhere. So here's a great game that I play with my dog all the time. And I found this video and I'm like, yeah, that's it. That's the game.
Hey guys, welcome back. So I've got a really quick video for you here. I actually shot this a couple months back with Wrigley and actually just completely forgot that I had this footage. So wanted to get this out to you guys because it's a really good game to play. It's a little hide and seek game that I play with Wrigley around the house. It's super simple, takes a little bit to work up to so your dog gets the concept of it, but a lot of dogs really enjoy this and have a lot of fun with it. And I have a lot of fun watching Wrigley play this game. So I incorporate that go to place behavior So Wrigley hangs out on her bed, kind of in a down stay. The go to place video I did film previous to this, you guys can go check it out to get that behavior with your dog. But I have her stay in one location. And while she's doing that, I go to hide the treat. Initially, I'm hiding it in very obvious places to her, things like that first one that she could clearly see where I put the treat. And then I'm slowly starting to hide it in more obscure type places that she has to use her nose really to sniff that treat out. So here she's really working for it. I have the volume muted on this because I had the stereo on in the background. But
get the idea of this video. One big question we get as trainers is if when we're asking people to implement more enrichment, and if I allow my dog to do this in this context, or if I allow my dog to do this behavior, won't that just encourage the behavior? Won't that just encourage foraging and searching on the countertops for food? And the answer is maybe. So really what it comes down to is how you're presenting that enrichment item or that activity. So dogs, luckily for enrichment's sake, they don't generalize very well at all. So that can be really frustrating for training because you're working on a behavior with your dog. So let's just use stay or sit as an example in the living room. You've been training sit in the living room and it's going beautifully. They've got it down. And then you go into the kitchen and you ask for the behavior. And then the dog's like, wait, what? What do you mean? Because they don't generalize very well. You have to teach them in almost every, or you have to teach them how to do the same behavior in multiple places and around multiple distractions. So that's actually at a benefit when it comes to this situation, because if you create the context that if you're in it, I love how she had the dog on the place and she's got treats in her hand. She's like, okay, you stay. I'm going to go hide this thing. That context, when I release you, go and forage and find that item. Now, if you were to have a handful of treats, come home from work, scatter them on the countertop table, go to the bathroom or go do something else, and your dog starts searching around for the food on the countertops, that is going to reinforce countertop surfing for sure. So it's just about the context that I think really makes a big difference. I know for busy boxes, I'm not sure if people are familiar with those, but those are for our big shredders out there. Creating a box that you shred up, you put treats in there and box and box and box, and then you close it up and give it to the dog to go to town and shred. If you ask your dog for a behavior and then present that item to them to have, and even if you put it in a totally different room or outside of, for the most part, dogs are going to learn, oh, in this situation, I can do that. And then obviously you're going to still implement management and training to make sure that it doesn't happen where you don't want it to happen, especially if it is a problem that you're having. But I do think it's important to give them this outlet, because we're not going to get rid of that drive and that need to perform these behaviors. So this will help with the training, not hinder it. Oops. Okay, so here we dive into our breed-specific behaviors. So we talked about species-specific. And now we're going to talk about breed-specific behaviors. So these are behaviors that we specifically bred our dogs to do. We selected for this behavior and we said, we're going to crank that up. I want the dog to do this for work purposes for us. So here's the video of a golden retriever doing what it's bred to do.
Good boy, come on. Hold.
Retrieve.
Hold.
A bird.
Hold. Hold.
And he's bred to hold the item in his mouth, not to shred it and destroy it, because they want the bird coming to them whole and not shredded and destroyed. They want the whole bird. So they're bred to, or they're trained and bred to gently hold something in their mouth and bring it to you. And it looks an awful lot like this, which I'm sure a lot of our retriever
without telling me you have a golden retriever.
Our retriever friends out there can relate to. And with That's all great, but when the dog's carrying around your dirty underwear, parading it around your friends, not so great. So how can we give this retriever the outlet to perform that behavior in a way that's not going to be a nuisance? So here we go. I love this. Everybody's working for the weekend. that's a little game of cleanup, training him to hold something in his mouth and put it away. We have our herding breeds. So this one is always so impressive to me, seeing
on the gate. So they don't get on that new driveway.
Border collies work. So these dogs are bred specifically to control movement. And they'll do this innately. Obviously, there's involved.
There. Push them up.
But your golden retriever looks like he's not going to be doing.
Push them up. Push them up. Wee.
So when you look at this dog in the city, I feel like most people who don't know the breed at all would see like, oh, this dog's a bad dog and he's out of control, pulling on leash. And what I see from this perspective, especially watching that video and seeing what they're bred specifically by us to do, I just see a dog that's really frustrated because he has this innate need and drive to do this thing, to control movement, and he just can't. Along with management and training, how can we allow this dog to perform that behavior of controlling movement, chasing an item and making it move and making it stop moving? How can we give them that in a way that will help with the training so that they're not as frustrated when you go into a training session with them? You can do something like this. Herding ball. So yeah, you can see the behaviors are all the same, but it's just on something that we're providing for them. Because obviously we're not all going to have cows in our backyard for our cattle dogs and border collies to chase around, but a ball, we can do that. Okay, so just going a little bit more into that breed specific behaviors. So most of these breed specific behaviors are genetically selected through the predation sequence, which is how dogs hunt and catch prey. So they go through this process when they're hunting. So they scent and track, eye and stalk, chase, grab bite, kill bite, possess, dissect, consume. And like the retriever we saw, possess is something that we selected for. So we found, oh, this golden retriever, he's really good at carrying things in her mouth. Okay, this one too, we're gonna breed them together. What we don't want, though, is the dissect and consume, because like I said, we want that animal coming back in whole so it can be cooked up. And so both of those images were from Caninology, and they gave me permission to use these pictures. But I think that they're really helpful in showing just what, you know, we bred these dogs to do. So beagles, scent hounds, scent and track, scattered treats or toys in the grass, scent work, hide and seek, possess. You know, for our retrievers, whatever they can carry to parade around with. So really just knowing what your breed is and what they're going to be predisposed to want to do can really, really help, especially if you're getting a new breed for the first time. Okay, so signs your dog's needs are not quite being met. They try to express their needs in undesirable ways. So destructive behavior, chewing, digging, easily overstimulated leash pulling, like we saw with that Aussie Shepherd, excessive barking or whining, excessive mouthing, nipping, urinating or defecating inappropriately, restlessness and inability to sleep. Obviously, some of these are also indicators of medical issues. So I want to preface it with that. So if you are seeing a sudden onset of these behaviors, then definitely check with your veterinarian before you just jump on an enrichment program. But if your dog's needs aren't being met, you will also see these behaviors as well. Like you see this collie on the shredded couch. So this was something that we actually, that I took from the zoo world. So we like to break up enrichment into different categories. So the different categories of enrichment include cognitive enrichment, so focusing on problem solving, encouraging your dog to think and learn. Physical enrichment, so focusing on body movement, physical exercise and fitness. Sensory enrichment, focusing on stimulating a dog's senses, sight, hearing, smell, touch, taste. And social enrichment, so focusing on positive interactions with same species, so dogs or humans, because dogs are human companions. They are naturally bred to be with people, and to, so we are considered one of their social, we are considered a part of that type of enrichment, social interactions, especially for our dogs that aren't necessarily, they don't necessarily like other dogs, but we can be a part of that. So nutritional enrichment as well. So that feeding type and methods, chewing, shredding, foraging. So throughout a dog's life, they go, these needs change. So it doesn't mean that not all of them need these things. It just means that it's going to take that much more to try and meet them. So that's why we have the bars. And this is all just based off my anecdotal evidence of what I created this graph, because I'm like, this is adolescence, every single category skyrocketed. So that's why I feel like trainers, we tend to see a lot of adolescent dogs with issues, because it's a lot more challenging to meet their needs than say a puppy, for example, where at least in terms of their physical and cognitive, puppies are there. The moment they step out the door, everything is exciting and new and novel. And they're constantly learning how to, you know, interact with their environment. So I would say that honestly, their cognitive, they don't need a whole lot of puzzles and training and problem solving skills, because they're doing it all the time anyway. And physical too, they're still developing and they're little. So just that zoomies running around, like they'll be pooped after a good little zoomie session. Whereas our adolescents, not so much. And again, this isn't to say that they don't have those needs. It's just, we're going to be able to meet them much easier as opposed to our adolescent dog. Now, breed types again. So I know some of you are looking at this and like, oh no, my toy dog has a lot. They can run around for hours. And while that's true, you can also meet their physical and cognitive and sensory needs a lot more than you can a herding breed, for example. Like they are going to need that. You're going to have to put in a lot more effort to meet those needs with a herding breed. But I have their social up high because they're designed to be lap dogs. They're designed to be with people. So that's, I feel like you tend to see a lot of those attention seeking behaviors with toy breeds because they want that social interaction a lot. And scent hounds, obviously sensory all the way up. So in the zoo world, we have this is called the spider enrichment framework. This is something that I think it was originated from Disney. I'm not entirely sure where it came from, but you can find a lot of papers on it. Just look up spider enrichment, in Google, what is it? Google Academy, Google, I don't know, that Google books thing. And so this is something that we used quite a bit. And S is for set goals, P is for planning, I is for implementation, D is for documenting, E is for evaluating, and R is for readjustment. So this is sort of what we would go based on whenever we were going to implement a new enrichment item or an enrichment schedule for a specific animal. So setting goals. So what is the goal for incorporating that enrichment, whether it be, again, an item or a schedule? To reduce destructive behavior, chewing, digging, reducing excessive barking or whining, reducing excessive mouthing or nipping, increasing sleep and relaxation, or to provide mental and physical stimulation. And then you're gonna wanna plan. So that's the P of the spider. So this is where I will say everything kind of looks a little bit, it looks a little challenging from here on out, but I'll say that this is the part that is that takes the most effort and is a little bit, you do have to sit down and actually do this portion. Everything after P, everything after planning is going to be pretty plug and chug. So this is the part that I want you to really sort of focus on. So the first thing I want you to do when it comes to planning is list behaviors that your dog enjoys. So this was my dog, for example. I took chasing, digging, chewing, and smelling. Obviously, if your dog has more or different, that you would do that for your individual dog. I'm not going to put swimming in there if my dog doesn't like to swim. So I'm not just going to go based off of dogs in general. It's going to be my individual dog. And then, so once you get those categories of what behaviors does my dog like, then you're going to break those into activities and items that allow your dog to express those behaviors. So chasing, for example, we've got flirt pole, flag lure course, chasing human or dog, rolling treats. So you take a treat, you roll it, your dog chases after it. Digging, you've got pile of leaves, a sand pit, ball pit, blanket. You go to the thrift store, get a bunch of blankets. You know, you set up a context where this is where you can do that behavior. And then chewing, smelling, so on. I also have a section for other, because even if, you know, you don't necessarily have it under a specific behavior, like play rope tug toy. My dog loves to play with a tug toy. That's not necessarily a part of chew, smell, dig, or chase, but I'm going to want to have that as a part of my list of items and activities to regularly give my dog. So this is the part that I feel like takes a little bit of time. And then you're going to want to take those items and activities that we created in that list. So here's that list again. And then we're going to break them into those categories that I mentioned earlier. So the social, cognitive, sensory, physical, and nutritional. And the reason we want to do this is because while we're creating our schedule, it's easy enough just to hit one category. You know, I played fetch with my dog. I ran with them quite a bit. We tend to see a lot of people focus on the physical side, but we're still neglecting all those other aspects. We've got the nutritional, sensory, cognitive, social aspect. I will say some of those items, so activities that we have, the flirt pole, you know, hide and treat and seek, all some of those activities are dual, like there are multiple categories for them. So I do want to put that in there. So that's why I have in parentheses, not only SE, but I have C for under nature walk, for example, under sensory, you see C next to it because that it's also cognitive as well. So I do want to make sure I have that. But this is essentially what you want to create is this. You can also add other categories if you know you want to go outside of those core five. If you want to go and if your trainer's saying, oh my gosh, you need to provide more chewing for your dog, you know, has, you need to add more chewing enrichment for your dog. Okay, well, I'm going to create a category just for chewing then. Or rest, our puppies, they tend to get a lot of physical exercise. And what the majority of our puppies need is rest. And so creating a category where we're encouraging that through relaxation training, a frozen Kong, licky mat, quiet time, whatever activity or item you can think of that can encourage that behavior. So resting, we can add that as a category. And then this is where the plug and chug. So you already did the hard work. You created, you know, the categories and with all the items in there. And then we're just going to put them in a schedule. So this is part is, it looks a lot, but this part's actually pretty easy. So this is where you can schedule ahead. If you're someone who likes to have your week already planned out for you, this is one option where you have Sunday through Saturday. You can do an entire month if you want, but I'd at least just start with a week, see how it goes. And then just try and hit every category once a day. That's how I like to at least just start it and to see how it goes when I'm creating a schedule. So this is where I just put in those items that I created in that list. So on Sunday, we're going to do this, this, this. And obviously, if you're planning ahead, you can, you know, oh, Wednesdays, I've got book club, I've got soccer. I know that's going to be a really busy day. So maybe I'm not going to do an agility session that day. Maybe you're going to switch it with something, but you're still going to try and keep that category, but maybe something a little simpler. So just this shaping a behavior, just a little training session instead. And then you also have this option. So this is alternative to scheduling ahead. You can schedule as you go. So using a process of elimination. So here's that list that we created earlier. So this is the planning portion that we did. And then here's the basic calendar. You can either use a planner, you can get a calendar, one of those 12-month calendars, or you can even just look up on Google calendar sheet, and it'll give you a sheet that you can just print out one sheet. And then what you're going to do is, okay, it's Monday. Let's cross out, let's do some of these things. So let's do, well, which one of these social ones can I do? Oh, I can play rope toy today. Okay, I'll put a little X here, write it in the calendar. Okay, what other, what, so I've got social, physical. I need a cognitive one. Let's see, okay, let's add shape. Let's do shape of behavior in here, and then I'll put a little X there. Okay, what am I missing? I've got social, physical, cognitive. Okay, I got social twice, but that's okay. Why not? I'm still missing N. I'm missing knuckle, or not knuckle. I'm missing nutritional. So then I'll go down to nutritional, and then I'll just, okay, I'll do this one. And I put a little X. And then you do that every day. And so this, I feel like, can be really helpful if you don't necessarily want to create an entire schedule every week. So this can be helpful. And then I have these X's here so that you try and make sure you're not doing the same thing every day. And there's a limit. So once you hit three X's, then you can't use that one for the rest of the week or the month or however you decide to do it. That's just a way so that you don't get into a habit of just doing the same thing every day. And then you document. So then you collect. This is where we sort of go back to our setting of our goal. We want to make sure that we're at least meeting our goal, or if we're not meeting our goal, we want to know this. That's why we're doing this whole spider, to make sure that the effort and the time that we're putting into doing enrichment, buying enrichment, that it's worth it. So document. So then this is where we're going to collect behavioral data related to our goal. We're going to track observable behaviors, either the frequency and or intensity. We're going to collect this daily. So we do want this to be very simple, a simple number system or a color system. The reason this needs to be simple is because we're collecting it daily. And if it's not simple, we're not going to do it. So try not to get too complicated with this. And also I can find it helpful to just leave a little area on my calendar for notes so that you can just write, oh, they didn't use this, or they did use this, or this was a great day. It just can help to look back, especially if you start to see trends. And so here's just an example of that scale. So we want to be able to see trends easily. You can make your description simple or detailed, but as long as the number system is easy, that's the part that I want to be, that has to be simple. And it can be helpful, I find, to document this right on the schedule or on the calendar sheet that you have. So here we have the goal, reducing barking at me. So we're going to track the behavior of barking. And here we have very simple green or number system, green, no barks, yellow, some barking, red, a lot of barking, or reducing mouthing behavior, or just providing more enrichment. We're going to then track engagement. So one, very engaged, two, somewhat engaged, three, no engagement. And then we're going to evaluate our data. After X amount of time, this could be after a week, this could be after a few weeks, after a month, however long you want to do this for, I would recommend longer than a week so you can really start to see trends. So whether that be, 2 to 3 weeks, that would be ideal. Obviously, the more data you collect, the more you can be able to make better conclusions on this. Do you see any trends? Is your data trending towards your goals? So this is that same calendar that we created, but we're on day 6 already. And every day after we did this, we just put, a little green dot, no barking, a little bit of barking, a lot of barking this day, no barking. So this would just make it very simple, and you can do whatever you want here. If you find, you want to put hearts on days that were good and then X's on days that weren't so good, that could be a way that you go about doing it. Whatever is easiest for you to do this process. And then here's my little note section where I just typed whatever I wanted to. You could leave this blank if there was nothing, but I put not interested in rock puzzle toy, very engaged with sandpit. So this can be really helpful. Obviously if they're not interested in this rock puzzle toy, then I'm going to take it out of, because it's not enriching. So I'm going to take it out of my enrichment schedule here, or my enrichment list. And I'm just going to replace it with something else. So what was rock toy puzzle under? It was under nutritional. So I'll just replace it with a different either puzzle item or another thing that I find to be filling that category. And then with this tracking system and the color system, you can easily see if you had this whole month down, you could easily see. And this is great, not only for enrichment, but if you're working on a behavior modification plan, just you could also see if you're trending in the right direction. And then you want to readjust. So if you notice red everywhere, you're going to be like, okay, well, something's not working here. I could either add or move items, change days or schedule type if there were challenges. So if you notice you're not actually able to do the things, I would write that in the note and leave it blank. You'd have the blanks on your calendar if you weren't able to do them. And if that's the case, then we need to reevaluate what we're doing. And you can also create a new category. And then also seek professional advice if needed. Obviously, if you're really struggling with meeting your dog's needs, or there might be a medical issue as well. So you definitely want to, you know, have your whole team on board when it comes to behavior. And these are the books that I mentioned earlier. The Canine Enrichment for the Real World is an amazing book. I highly, highly recommend it. They, I think, have 14 categories, but it's different than the way I'm doing it. But it's very helpful, especially for like behavior modification. Meet Your Dog. This is a great book as well by Kim Brophy. This book really dives deep into the breed specific behaviors that we discussed earlier. So if you're looking to get a new breed of dog, this would be a great spot to look, where she does dive into enrichment for specific breed types. And this Canine Enrichment book is just great for good ideas. Google is also a great source. So when you're going back and you're like, okay, my dog loves to dig, and you're like, okay, but like I have nothing, then Google what are great enrichment options indoors for digging? And then a bunch of stuff will pop up. So that's why I really love creating these categories and thinking about it this way of like, what does my dog actually like to do? So final takeaways. Dogs rely solely on us to provide opportunities for them to express their behaviors. Many nuisance behaviors are normal dog behaviors. Every animal has specific needs that we can address to ensure we are providing optimal welfare. And by planning, implementing, and evaluating enrichment regularly, we can help curb unwanted behaviors and better allow opportunities for a dog to be a dog. And that's my boy. And questions?
Yeah, this was fantastic. Do you want me to read them off, or do you want to read them out?
I can read them out. Let's see, what do we got? One has a small yard. What are some things we can install to enhance enrichment? It depends on the behavior that you want to focus on. And again, like that's where Google can be our best friend, really. Like, go back to, what does your dog like to do? If it's digging in particular, especially with a small yard, I would look into Google for that one and determine which behaviors your dog really likes to do. The long line city walk isn't feasible. Is it okay to give a dog a bit more agency on a 6-foot line during walks? Totally. Yeah. So what I like to do when I am walking my dog on a 6-foot line, and I would do that as well, is I will just try and keep it loose as best as you possibly can. And dogs do walk faster than us. So hopefully if they're spending a lot of time sniffing and zigzagging, you won't have to be running up ahead of them. But so that would be my biggest advice if you're using a 6-foot line, is to just try and keep up with them if you can, and encourage sniffing. That would be my best advice, but obviously a long line is going to be your best bet for that. I know in the city it can be tough. Any suggestions for an extremely fearful dog that is stressed by any change in his environment? I think it depends on what the change is, but trying to keep dogs thrive on routine, and they thrive on familiarity of things. So I would try and create a safe space that your dog is very familiar with and knows, so that when there is a change, he at least can go back to that. So when it comes to this, kind of relates, but not totally, you'll kind of see where I'm going with this, but like when I take my dog to a winery, or when I'm working on winery training or taking my dog out and about, that's a totally different environment, especially when you're first training that those type of skills to just relax and hang out when there are other dogs, people, food, all of that stuff. And while it's not necessarily fearful stress, it can be a very stressful environment for dogs. And so I really love having that go to place cue, or having a relax on a mat and bringing that mat to that environment. So at least there's some familiarity of like, okay, I don't know exactly what to do here, but I know what that is. And I know I can feel safe on it. So, and then obviously you would want to build up towards that type of environment, but that can really help. So having some sort of safe space, a safe room in that environment can be really helpful. My dog loves those hide and seek stuffy toys and shredding things like paper, cardboard, etc., but started eating both. So I can't give him either of them anymore. Any ideas for replicating those activities with things he can't, won't eat? So that's a big one. So yes, if our dogs are eating the item, or there's any risk of a medical injury, then like 100% full stop, we're not going to do that. But there are things you can do. So one, for that one in particular, for shredding, if you've got a big shredder, a head of lettuce can be great, and they're super cheap. You can just buy a few heads of lettuce and just poke some hole, like tiny holes, and shove some treats in there and just let them go to town on a head of lettuce. Cause then if they eat it, it's food. They can eat a little bit of lettuce. That's fine. So just looking for edible objects that they can shred and destroy can be really helpful. I will say, keep an eye on your dog, especially if this is the first time you're offering them shredding things. Cause what I do find is that we sort of have that panic mode because we see this foreign object in our dog's mouth and they look like they're munching. And so we're so fearful that they're going to swallow it. But the majority of the time, not all the time, there are a lot of dogs that do still swallow things, but the majority of times, if you just watch your dog, they'll end up spitting it out and then going on shredding it. I'm not a vet, this is not my territory, but if from what I'm familiar with, as long as it's just a tiny little, if they swallow a tiny chunk while you're testing this theory, it's not the end of the world. But obviously you are going to want to reevaluate that type of enrichment item. Okay. I've taught my now 12-month-old Golden to fetch different toys when he is mooching, sucking on his stuffy, and then starts chewing the baby. I will tell him to go get his fish, which is a Benabone. Oh, so this is just in response to, yeah, that's a great idea. I love that. Having a cue of go get your thing. That having cues can really help make that context very clear of, in this situation, you do this thing, and in this situation, you don't. For those who don't have a fenced yard or have a small one, you can rent someone else's yard for a small fee. That's a great point. Yep. This can be a great option for your dog. So they do have something called Sniff Spot. I wish there were more options in DC because they're really limited. So if you have a big yard and you're in DC, sign up for Sniff Spot. Because it's such a great outlet for our dogs, especially for our fearful dogs. So yeah, check out Sniff Spot. You live in an area with a lot of parks. Yep. So if city walks, like I showed you, aren't necessarily right for your dog because they're not quite there yet for with training purposes, or they're just fearful and that can be a lot for them. Then yeah, definitely taking your, there are a lot of great areas like Rock Creek Park, obviously finding those trails. There is a website, I'm not sure, but Google, where you can find out the busy times of day where, trails tend to be a little bit busier versus other times of day. So I would look into that, especially if you have a fearful dog. Is there ever too much? Is it detrimental, or can it become detrimental if he plays daily? Sessions are 20 to 90 minutes, depending on their energy. You can focus on one category too much, for sure. So if all we're focusing on is play, 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 and our dogs are not learning to relax, since that's why hitting all of those categories, I feel like, is really important. So that sniffing and that sensory experience, and then the nutritional, sitting there chewing, is naturally going to help calm them down. The active eating, so really anything under that nutritional category, should help reduce arousal and encourage relaxation. So yeah, you can definitely focus on one category too much. Any tips for picky dogs, for a Kong, licky mat fillings? We've tried what feels like it all, and nothing really motivates him to engage him. Lower end of kibble to the higher end of boiled chicken. It is a long list. Did we create the pickiness? His regular food is a mix. I mean, maybe that isn't necessarily the right type of thing for your dog. I would just test out different options. Maybe not necessarily like a liquidy paste, but maybe try, chews instead. So, I mean, I would obviously check with your vet when it comes to chews, but like bully sticks can be really great. So maybe that's a different type of oral stimulation that your dog needs, instead of, because Kongs are really focused on that licking behavior, which is great. But if your dog isn't really into that and isn't really into the food type for that, then that would also be an option, just to explore different kinds. But honestly, if you just look on Google, like different types of food for Kongs, there's a lot of great options out there. My go-to is usually canned food. So some sort, like whatever type of diet your dog has as kibble, I get the wet food version of that. So at least there's like quite a bit of good nutrients in that. And then I'll mix in some layers of tasty stuff. So maybe put some treats at the bottom that I know that they like, and then put a layer of like cream cheese to get them going. But obviously I'm not going to fill the whole thing with cream cheese, because that would be a lot. Now, this person said that the dog doesn't like them frozen, but will eat them fresh. That's a great idea. Yeah. Along those lines, any recommendations for dogs that would rather bury than chew the chews you give them? I mean, that's a behavior, right? So burying a bone, and that's a natural, normal dog behavior. So like, that's enrichment in and of itself. If your dog's going to bury it, not necessarily chew it, I wouldn't say you don't necessarily, that doesn't mean you don't have to give it to them, because they're doing a behavior that's a natural, normal dog behavior. And as long as it's not causing any issues, and then if they decide to chew on it later, great. But maybe I wouldn't go and buy multiple chews. But what I would do then is maybe take that same chew once they're not engaged with it, put it away, and then give it to them again, let them bury and dig it again. So you're not going out and buying more chews that they're not chewing up. If socializing with other dogs is tricky, dog parks are a challenge, and play dates are hard to set up, is 1 day a week of a vetted daycare sufficient? And this is where it comes down to that data aspect. So I would, you know, start to keep track. How is my dog's behavior after 1 day a week at the daycare? And then, you know, if you still find that you're having issues, or that they're behavioral, you know, your dog just seems like they have so much energy, you could try doing, you know, 2-3 days instead, and just track that data, see how it's trending. And if, you know, you see there's still a lot of that crazy energy, then maybe that's not where we should be focusing the enrichment on. Maybe there is another aspect that we could be doing, and it's not necessarily socializing with other dogs, because again, socializing with us is still socialization. I think that's it. Carrie, did I get all of it? I think I did.
Did you get the, what can we do for persistent barking in the evening?
So for persistent barking in the evening, that, I mean, I would want to determine what they're barking at. Because again, barking is a normal, so alerting, that's a normal dog behavior. As long as they're not staying in that hyper aroused state. So management and training can be really helpful for that aspect. But then also, what is it that they're so stimulated by outside that they're barking at? Is it a good activity that they're doing? Is it, or are they just getting really worked up and hyper aroused? Because if that's the case, then I would figure out what's the function of that behavior, and is it something that we want to, I don't know if that's not necessarily something that enrichment would be there to address for that specific thing, but that could mean that the dog's not necessarily being mentally stimulated enough. So they're seeking it out. They're like window watching, they're watching TV on their own. So I would focus on management and training around the window there, or whatever they're barking at. And then focus on other activities in that enrichment list that might be able to give them more of that mental stimulation and calming as well.
Let's see. How about, can things like hiking be both sensory and physical?
Totally. Yeah. So I think I had that one as cognitive. I don't remember which ones I had that as, and sensory probably. But yeah, so I try, when I'm making my categories, I like to kind of limit them to two. So I don't know if you noticed, but in all of my categories I had, or under all my activities and items, I only had two of the categories listed. Some of them you could easily, you know, say, hey, but there's probably nutritional in that one as well, or sensory, but I like to limit it to just two so that I'm doing more than just one thing a day. So when I'm creating my schedule, I'm not just like, well, I did a nature walk, so good for everything. But that's just me, because I know I want to do more with my dog, but definitely there can be more categories, and especially for hiking. That's why that one can be a great enrichment. Just taking your dog out into the woods, letting them sniff, letting them explore, letting them, if you do some treat scatter in the woods, like then there's taking care of nutrition as well. So that one can be a great, hiking is just magical for dogs.
One came in, and I don't know, so this one's kind of more of a training question, but there's got to be some enrichment we can use to help with. What can I do about high drive prey pulling on leash to go after squirrels? And then someone else added, or blowing leaves.
Blowing leaves. So that's definitely prey drive for sure. So I would Flirt poles are great for dogs like to go after squirrels. There's also tug enoughs too, which is something that you can just take with you. It's essentially a flirt pole, but it's a handheld one. And also having your dog, this is one that I've learned recently from Instagram. So you can learn a lot just by looking online, where you just take a treat and you just have your dog track it with their eyes and you just go like this. I think it was from the, I forget the book. Darn.
It's Simone Mueller's Hunting Together. Yes, that's it.
Yes, thank you. Simone, she does this game and my dog's here, so I can show you actually. So this is sort of that game where you just hold a treat in your hand and you just have them watch. You just have it move like prey. You move it slow, move fast. And then you throw it and you let them get it. So that's a good one for prey, especially if they have a high prey drive. Blowing leaves, I don't know about that one. I'd assume same thing because it's all about just that like movement. Definitely a flirt pole for sure, especially because leaves are flying up in the air. So you could hold the flirt pole up high. I've also seen, which I think is a great idea, so that with flirt poles, you can attach something to the end of the flirt pole where they can shred and actually eat what's inside of it. So take like a hair tie or something and wrap around the flirt pole a plushie portion or rope, whatever you're using, and put like a wrapped up piece of paper with treats in it. So not only do they get the whole sequence if they want, where they stalk the item and then they chase it and then they capture it and then they shred it and then they get to enjoy the prize inside. So that's a great option. What's this one? I have a leash reactive Jack Russell Terrier that loves walks, but hard to find places where she can get out without being triggered. Definitely. I mean, I feel like a lot of those in any indoor activity that you can do flirt pole inside. I really, really love that down stay. And my dog loves to do that game where I'll go downstairs, hide a tree, really get their sniffer going. Jack Russell Terriers need a lot of that physical exercise, but that flirt pole that I had mentioned, especially terriers, they're designed to do that whole predatory sequence where they grab, catch, kill, consume. That's why they can make great rat hunting dogs. But doing the flirt pole with the actual paper with treats inside for them to shred and consume, it would be a great option for that dog. What was the name of the book you just referenced? The Canine Enrichment for the Real World by Allie Bender and Emily Strong, and then the Meet Your Dog book by Kim Brophy, and the Canine Enrichment, The Book Your Dog Needs You to Read by Shay Kelly.
And if you're looking just for random enrichment activities, there are two or three canine enrichment webinars that we've done in the past that are just loads and loads of ideas for activities. And those you can find on the Your Dog's Friend YouTube page. You can just search on there for canine enrichment. So I have a question of my own.
Yeah.
And it's not necessarily dogs, but can you tell us about an enrichment activity that you created that made the biggest difference for an animal that you've worked with?
So I created a few. One that I loved, well, there were a few. So one I actually got, it's funny because I was working at the zoo while also working with dogs also as a volunteer at Animal Welfare League of Arlington. I was working there and they had these little scent tubes that were the coolest things for these dogs. And they're on each kennel and they're just these tubes with holes in them. And then they're PVC pipes, you'd uncap them and then they'd spray them with lavender, shove them inside the tube pipes and then close them. And I thought that was brilliant because with elephants, it's so hard to find enrichment for them because they can destroy and will destroy everything and anything that they can. So those PVC pipes were actually great. In the barn and in the ECC, we have mesh panels where we do a lot of our training, but it helps. It's elephant proof panels where it's just basically mesh. And so I would hang those PVC pipes on the ground or on those mesh so that they would, and we'd put scents in it just like we did at the shelter. So it was kind of cool coming full circle with like that. So that was a really great one where we could put all different types of, because elephants, I mean, their sense of smell is insane, just like dogs, similar to dogs. So that was a really good one for them. They would just sit there, suck at the smells. And also there's another really cool one that I made where along the mesh, because again, it was so, you had to get really creative with this. There's another one where I had a PVC pipe that was strung along the mesh all the way down the wall. So it was way up high. And I created a popcorn cannon. So at the bottom, the elephant would blow. And then at the top, it would blow a bunch of popcorn out of the top. And then they would have to then forage around for it. So it encouraged quite a bit of behaviors, the sensory and the smelling, but then the blowing behavior, which is a natural behavior for them. And then the having to forage. So that was kind of fun. Two big ones that I had fun with.
Fantastic. This was so good. It was just absolutely excellent. So again, thanks to everybody who joined us today. Thank you so much, Kayleigh, for presenting